young man's preaching and how he had electrified the crowds and how he had healed. And he thought, this man must have something that I need. And he came to Jesus and he said, good master. He was wanted to flatter him, and Jesus said, I don't need any flattery. Oh, no one is good save God alone. What is it that you want? He said, I hear that you have the secret of eternal life. Jesus said, well, you've been a good person, and you've never, in the tradition of our religion, tell me, what is this all about? Well, he said, I've obeyed all the commandments. And Jesus said, well, that's all right. But you know, you have a fatal illness, a fatal spiritual illness. You are totally wedded to what you have and your possessions and your wealth. So I'm going to give you a prescription. It's going to be very painful, but it will make you compassionate, which is the whole purpose of life, is to love one another, is to be compassionate. And if you have missed that, you've missed the whole meaning of religion and life. So, go sell everything you have, give it away to those in need, and come and follow me, and you will find a whole new way of living. You will be vulnerable to others. You will not be isolated in your wealth. No, I don't want that prescription. And the young man went away sorrowful. In the reservation in which I live, Pilgrim Place, is a haven for retired clergy. And I have passed through many stages in my 24 years here. Right now I'm in a 32-unit housing called assisted living. And I seem, probably to you, I seem like an old person. But when I go to breakfast there, I'm the baby. Everybody in the late 90s. Anyway, they have a social worker that comes to us every day and tries to stimulate us and get our minds to working again. And every Thursday we sit around in a big circle and we have a question that we are all to address. And last Thursday we had a wonderful question. If you were elected president, what is the first thing you would do? Think about that. If you were elected president, what is the first thing you would do? Well, that mystified. There was a long silence. One woman spoke up and said, well, I would pray that I would have wisdom and strength enough to do something right for all the people of the country. And then someone said something very interesting. He said, I've read in Fortune magazine that there are 900 billionaires in this country. 900 billionaires. Think about $1 billion. You know what it is? It's 1,000 million. 1,000 million. And some of these billionaires have more than thousands of billions. And I would summon them all to come to the White House. And dare say some of them would come very reluctantly. And the White House wouldn't even be big enough for 900. They would have to go meet the Constitution. And I would say to them, ladies and gentlemen, you have thrived in this economy, in this free enterprise system, in the American system. America has been very good to you, and you have amassed billions and billions of dollars. And you complain about taxes, and you complain about government. So I'm going to ask you to solve one problem for me. All over this country, there are thousands. young of our veterans who risked their lives for this country. And I divided 50 states into 900 billionaires, and that came out to 18 billionaires for each state. So I'm assigning you, 18 of you, to each one of the 50 states, and I want you to go there and sit down with the governor and work out a plan that within 3 months you will rehabilitate all the dilapidated empty buildings in every city in America. And within 30 to 60 days we'll move every homeless people into a place, starting with the veterans and the homeless families and children and the homeless single people. And at the end of that short period of time, I want you to have everybody housed. And you can set up child care centers, and you can set up vocational training programs. But you could easily solve this terrible problem. In Los Angeles County, where we live, 55,000 homeless people who sleep in empty buildings, who sleep on the sidewalk, whose children go to school from the back seat of cars. And you have so much power. You have 1,000 men. Well, I suspect that like the rich young ruler, they would go away sorrowful. I don't think they would be quite ready to meet that challenge. But there's a trouble with this whole story. And it's a trouble we all have when we read the scripture. We apply the scripture to someone else, to the rich, to the rulers. We think that, and yet, as I read the scripture, I always read it in such a fashion that every single word there is addressed to me. It is addressed to me. And do I have any symptoms of a fatal spiritual illness? Am I attached to things and possessions and money? Does that give me security against life? Do I trust in that more than I trust in God? More than I am willing to be giving and compassionate to others? But that is something every one of us must ask ourselves. Because we all have stuff. We all have cars. I don't anymore, but, and I live in a community where little by little by little, everyone in my community has to begin the process of divesting themselves. I started out in 1988 in a beautiful house with all my furniture. And then my dear sweet Betty Jane died, and I was forced to move into an apartment, and that meant giving away and getting rid of some of my stuff. And then I lived 10 years in this wonderful apartment with the familiar things that I had, and I had a beautiful little car, and then I had back surgery, and I became for a while totally paralyzed. My life hung by a thread. And everything was given away, except that I still possessed the car. And I remember the day when they wheeled me out into the driveway, and I watched that little white Mazda go off into the distance on the top of a truck. I gave it to my granddaughter in Ohio so that she could drive it to school where she taught. Goodbye, car. Oh, how painful that is. How painful for all our people. We finally